Please rise. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. The text for this morning's sermon is our epistle lesson as written in the 22nd chapter of Revelation. Behold, I am coming soon, bringing my recompense with me to repay each one for what he has done. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the first and the last, the beginning and the end. Blessed are those who wash their robes so that they may have the right of the tree of life and that they may enter the city by the gates. Outside are the dogs, the sorcerers and the sexually immoral and the murderers and idolaters and everyone who loves and practices falsehoods. I, Jesus, have sent my angel to testify to you about these things. For the churches, I am the root and the descendant of David, the bright morning star. The Spirit and the bride said, come. And let the one who hears say, come. And let the one who is thirsty come. And let the one who desires take the water of life without price. He who testifies to these things said, surely I am coming soon. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. You may be seated. Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Last week, my dear friends, and the weeks prior to that, you've been hearing sermons from the Epistle of Revelation. Why is that? Why so much preaching from Revelation? Well, in these Sundays of Lent, we know that we celebrate and remember the resurrection of our Lord. And in his resurrection, Revelation confirms for us that he did rise, that he did ascend, as he did and as we celebrate last Thursday. And in Revelation, God opens for us, he lifts the veil just a tiny bit, and we can look under the veil and see what is happening in heaven. And see what you and I will be doing in heaven forever. These sermons from Revelation have shown us that in heaven we are to have no fear. There is no pain, no mourning, no crying. There is no more death. We see that in heaven there is worship and praise of the worthy one, the one who lives, the one who will never die. And because he is worthy, and because he will never die, you have been made worthy. And you will never die. But wait, you say, Pastor, I will die. Just look across the road. Many of my relatives are there. That's true. You will die physically. But because of what Jesus has done for you here, you will never die spiritually. So over the past 6 weeks, you have your proof. And in that proof, we say, amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Revelation provides that proof for you. Do you need any other? God himself shows you the importance of the resurrection and that in his resurrection, you too will be resurrected. But today, once again, Jesus reconfirms what he continually tells us. He says, behold, I am coming soon. Yes, Jesus is coming. He is coming according to his divine schedule, not ours. He is coming according to that time, the fullness of time, as he did in his first coming. Today, Jesus gets your attention with these words. Behold, pay attention. He is saying to the church, my friends, he's saying to each and every one of you, I am coming soon. And what is he bringing with him? In the ESV, he says that he's bringing his recompense. You heard it in a hymn of the day this morning. In our text today, it says that he is bringing his reward from the NIV. This reward is the spoils of his victory. Isaiah wrote
and said it this way, "Behold, his reward is with him, and his recompense is before him." And David reconfirmed it in the psalm. "Give to them according to their work, and according to the evil of their deeds. Give to them according to the work of their hands. Render them their due reward." What is this reward that Jesus is bringing? What are the spoils of his victory? Well, we know that in Lutheranism we call it law and gospel. His reward is eternal life for those who believe that he is the Messiah, the bright morning star, the root of David. For you, he is bringing his reward, and he gives it to you freely. But there's also a warning here, isn't there? There's also the law side. He's bringing a reward for those who lived a life that was devoid, that was without Christ. Those who do not believe, those who refuse to believe, he is bringing for them their reward, that because of the works of their hands, they will die. They will experience the second death, spiritual death. And as you heard from our text this morning, they are the ones who are outside the wall. They are the ones who will be outside with the dogs. More on that in a moment. So here's the reward that Jesus speaks of. And in this reward, Jesus reconfirms for you and I his authority and his divinity. How does he say it? "I am the Alpha and the Omega. I am the first and the last, the beginning and the end." These terms are so vastly important for you and I. These are royal titles of our great King and Redeemer. Two of these titles also apply to God our Heavenly Father, but one of these titles applies only to Jesus. First, let's take a look at the Alpha and the Omega. God himself, the Father, calls himself the Alpha and the Omega, as does Jesus. And in this, God is telling us that he is beyond creation, that he always has been and always will be. It refers to the magnitude of his eternal presence as God, and that he as God is far and above each and every one of us, far and above his creation. This title speaks of his eternal presence, apart and independent of his creative acts and the world of which he has created, the world that he brought into existence. God the Father and your Savior Jesus Christ is the Alpha and the Omega. They are the creators. The last term that Jesus uses for himself is that he is the beginning and the end. The Father also uses the same title for himself. That the beginning and the end refers to the act of creation. That creation began with him and it will end with him, because he is the beginning and the end of all things. He is the beginning and the end of all creation. He made all things new and restores his creation. Jesus, your Savior, has purified and will purify creation. We just haven't seen it yet, but on that great last day, the New Jerusalem will come down out of heaven and creation will be purified. Not only are we purified by the blood of the Lamb, but the creation itself will be purified because of the Lamb, because he is the first and the last. All of this because of his redeeming actions that he lovingly showed toward each of you and that he will show toward creation itself. But then there's a term that Jesus only uses for himself. And my friends, this term is the foundation of your faith. Jesus says that he is the first and the last, the beginning and the end. He says that in the first and the last, I am the one who has founded the church. I am the foundation of the church. Jesus uses this title, the first and the last, for himself. And he uses it three times in Revelation. Three times he says that he is the first and the last, reconfirming, telling us that he is the creator of the church and that the church is built upon him, the rock. And this is the faith of the church. Your faith is built upon the one who is the first and the last. My friends, this title is so important for you because this title, as we saw, is in the center of the other two. Jesus pulls everything together. He pulls the creation together. He pulls us together. He pulls the church together. And it's pulled together under the authority, under the power, under the redeeming work of the worthy one, the living one, Jesus Christ. Yes, Jesus is the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last, and he always will be. He is your Redeemer, your King, the one who's taken away all your sin. Because of this, the Lord announces a blessing to each of you. He says that you who have washed your robe in the blood of the Lamb, you will be given authority over the tree of life. You will have the privilege to enjoy the tree of life forever and ever and ever. It will never be taken from you because of what Jesus has done for you. And not only that, he says that you now have the right to enter into the city by the gate. The gates are open for you. The gate of heaven is wide open because of the Son. And because of him, you can enter into the gate. But one day, one great last day, the gate will be closed. And outside of the gate, as Jesus says, and as he said last week from chapter 21, outside are the dogs. You know those dogs, don't you? The ones who are always howling at you, always barking at you. Come follow us. Come run with our pack. Come and be a sinner. Don't worry about tomorrow. Eat, drink, and be merry. Tomorrow will care for itself, as Jesus said. But according to them, tomorrow doesn't matter. Live for today. Live for today, and as you run with the dogs, you will die tomorrow. Jesus also says outside of the gate with those dogs are those who practice sorcery. The Greek word actually lends us to the thought that those who practice sorcery use magic arts. And part of magic arts is the use of illicit and illegal drugs. That's what the Greek word says. That's what Jesus is saying. All those who are involved in evil are using mind-deluding things. Not only drugs, but magic arts. They will die. Those who are sexually immoral, they will die. Don't tell me Jesus isn't talking about homosexuality or lesbianism. He is. After all, we remember, Jesus is the incarnate God of the Old Testament. And what did God say in the Old Testament? That a man who lies with a man will die. And a woman who lies with a woman will die. The sexually immoral will be cast into the lake of fire. Not only that, those who are murderers, not physically necessarily, but the ones who use this tiny little weapon in their mouth as they murder their friends by gossip and innuendo and falsehoods. And those who practice idolatry. My friends, we know what idolatry is. It's anything that you and I place above our Heavenly Father. If you place anything above Him and you worship it, Jesus is saying on the last day, you will die. And those who practice falsehoods, those who believe lies and follow those lies, ultimately the lies of Satan, they will follow their father right into hell as they too are cast into the lake of fire. Ominous words from a holy God who cannot stand anything unholy to stand before him. You see, there's no gray area, is there? Either you are inside the city or you are outside the city. My friends, how can we apply this to ourselves? How does this apply to us here at Shun? There are many who are outside the city, who are outside the doors of this church today. As a matter of fact, many of your relatives, many of whom I know and some I don't, have never been in this church since they were confirmed. They have never graced the inside of this church. Usually what I hear is, "Pastor, I can't come to church. If I do, why, it may fall down on me." If it may fall on you, that's fine. Better the church fall on you than you be cast into hell. So, what are we to do about this? My friends, you and I, we both know that one of my responsibilities is to warn you. To warn you that the day is coming, as Jesus tells us. The great last day is coming. One day you and I will stand before our Savior. And then our heart will be flayed open. It will become bare before Him. We'll have no excuse. Either we will be judged according to the law and die, or you will be judged according to the gospel and live. Either you will be outside with the dogs and the sorcerers and the sexually immoral, all of those who practice murder and practice idolatry and speak lies, or you will be inside the gate, inside the city wall, partaking of the tree of life forever, living in the light, in the brightness of the bright morning star. My friends, that's why our stewardship committee and I are working on a letter. We are going to reach out to these of whom never come to church, those who are poor stewards of what God has given them. Ultimately, my desire is to visit them, to seek them out, and to warn them. If they repent, we will welcome them back. If they refuse, if they desire to be outside the city wall, well, as God told Ezekiel, you have warned them, and now their blood is on their head. So we will warn them. We will warn them to be good stewards. We will warn them of the importance of being at this altar and being in communion with their Lord and Savior. Because I do not want anyone, especially the members of your family, to be cast into the lake of fire. Oh, it's not my responsibility that they will die. Their blood will be on their head. But it is my responsibility if I do not warn them. And it's also your responsibility. You too must warn them. And that's why our stewardship committee and myself, we're going to begin this process. It's going to be biblical, it's going to be gospel-centered, and our desire is that they will repent and that they will return. Therefore, on that great last day, your Savior and my Savior will look at them and say, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the gate and partake and have authority over the tree of life." And the church said, "Come." And the witnesses said, "Come." You and I, my friends, we say, "Come. Come, Lord Jesus." And therefore, as we proclaim His authority, His kingship, and His love for us, by calling out to Him, "Come, Lord, come," Jesus gives us a final promise. "Yes, I am coming soon." This should sound familiar to us. Jesus said the same thing in John chapter 14. This text you often hear at funerals. And we say this text, we speak this text for a purpose. John chapter 14, Jesus said, "And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, that where I am, you may be also." And the church said, "Amen. Come, Lord Jesus. Come quickly. Amen." Please rise.
And the peace of God that surpasses all human understanding. Guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen.